same sin, now I am clean. The cross he carried bore my burden. The nails that held him set me free.
Scars of suffering brought me healing. He spilled his blood to fill my soul.
His crown of thorns made me royalty. His sorrow gave me joy.
Scripture reading is found in the book of Psalms, chapter 32, and verse 1. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. May God bless the reading of his word. And I would like to say a happy Sabbath. Hey, I'm glad that you are happy to be here. Have you ever had a Bible text that bothered you? No? Yes, okay. Well, as a young man in school, I had a Bible assignment that our teacher gave us. And in fact, my wife was There we were not married at that time, just students together. And we were told we had to memorize 200 Bible texts. And the teacher could give us the verse, and we had to tell it where it was found, or vice versa. And one of those texts was found in Isaiah chapter 58. Now, if you have your Bibles, you might like to follow along, and I don't care whether you're using electronic or paper. Either one works. In fact, I probably will use both today. Isaiah chapter 58, verse 13. If you turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shalt honor him, not doing thine own ways, nor finding thine own pleasure, or speaking thine own words. Now, I don't know how you interpret that. You know, we all interpret the words that we read, but you know, when you read about pleasure, is that something enjoyable? Must not be. People here in this church don't like pleasure. I don't know about you, but I like pleasure. And if I'm reading this correctly, I can't enjoy artichoke and asparagus on Sabbath. And my wife, oh my, she can't have mashed potatoes at all because she enjoys them. In fact, she fasted this week a little bit. And at the end of the fast, you know what she wanted? Mashed potatoes. And I made sure she had some. But you see, when a young person reads this text, it basically says, if it's fun, you can't do it on Sabbath. You see what I'm saying? And yet it says to make that Sabbath a delight. Now, how can you have it both ways? It doesn't compute. And so, all my life I've struggled. Because you see, I've always enjoyed Sabbath. I've always looked forward to Sabbath. I've looked forward to going to Sabbath school and our song service, singing the hymns that we love. I loved being with my friends on Sabbath. I loved with my parents, took us to the beach. I loved it when they took us to the mountains. I loved it when they took us to the deserts. And you know, you may say, you enjoyed the desert? Oh, yeah. My folks taught me how, you know, if you get down on your hands and knees, maybe all the way down on your belly, and look real careful, you might find some beautiful flowers. Or you might see some interesting insects. You see, no matter where we are, there's things that God has created, things of beauty. things to be enjoyed. And so this text always bothered me. Doing thine own pleasure. And then I read the text in a different version. And you know, that I found to be important. Because sometimes it brings out something that you hadn't seen before. And so the other thing is, I'd taken that text all by itself. And I'd taken it completely out of the whole chapter. What is the chapter Isaiah 58 about? Any idea? Well, let's look at verse 1. It kind of gives us a good idea. Verse 1, and I'm going to read it from the English translation. It's a little more modern language. It says, "Cry aloud, do not hold back, lift up your voice like a trumpet." Anybody like trumpets around here? Oh, a couple. I can think of some trumpet and organ music that just thrills my soul. I get goosebumps whenever I hear it. And so it says, lift up your voice like a trumpet and do what? Declare to my people their transgressions and the house of Jacob their sins. That sets the tone for this whole chapter. And then Isaiah goes on to start painting a picture. Now, I don't know about you, but words create a picture in my mind. And I know that the picture that I get may not be the same one you get, because your background, your upbringing, your education, all may play into the picture that you get. But I get a picture of somebody with a silver trumpet, and the blast just fills this room. Because here he says, cry aloud, do not hold back, lift up your voices like a trumpet. So we're going to go looking. Here's the picture. Yet they seek me daily and delight to know my ways. In other words, the people every day went for worship. And they seem to enjoy it as if they were a nation that did righteousness and did not forsake the judgments of their God. They ask me for righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Now notice this. Look at the next part here. Why have we fasted and you see it not? Why have we humbled ourselves and you take no knowledge of it? Behold, in the day of your fast, you seek your own pleasure. Now, right here, we're going to stop, because this translation has a little number one beside the word pleasure. And what does that mean when you find that in your Bible? What does that mean? Anybody? A footnote or another reference, or an alternate meaning for that word. Because you see, none of us speak the original language. And sometimes the original word can mean several things in my language. And so the translators have to try and find the best word to take the place of that Hebrew word. And the alternate there, instead of pleasure, is business. Now, let's read that again. Behold, in the day of your fast, you seek your own business. And that fits with what comes next. And oppress all your workers. What a picture do you get there? You see them fasting, making sure that they're doing everything right. In fact, as you read on down, they put on sackcloth, they sit in the ashes, they let everybody know that they're fasting. And yet, what does it say? At the same time, what are they doing? Maybe I better read it again. Behold, on the day of your fast, you seek your own business and oppress all of your workers. You fast only to quarrel and to fight and to hit with a wicked fist. That's a horrible picture. It doesn't match with my understanding of what fasting is all about. You know, I think of the story of Jonah. You know the story, don't you? Jonah went into Nineveh and said, 40 days and this place is going to be destroyed. The people heard it, and the king heard it. And what did he say? What did the king of Nineveh say? Let everybody, all 200,000 of you, fast and seek the Lord. And one more thing. Turn from your wickedness. And maybe the Lord will turn from this destruction. And you know the outcome. You know the outcome. The people fasted, they turned from their wickedness, the king turned from his wickedness, and the Lord did not strike Nineveh. In fact, he put off that judgment for about 130 years until Nineveh had forgotten the lesson from Jonah. And then as we read on down, verse 6, is not this the fast I choose, I God, to loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the straps of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house, and when you see the naked to cover him and not hide yourself from your own flesh. And then, verse 10, if you pour yourself out for the hungry and desire the satisfy the desires of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in darkness and your gloom shall be as noonday. Now, when I have read this text in the past, I've always thought of it in probably the same way you did, of giving somebody food to fulfill their hunger. But it came to me that there are other ways of being hungry. And I couldn't help but think of a Sabbath in my wife and I's history. You see, we have two children, and our boy, the oldest one, has not made the best choices in life. And one Friday, we sat in court with him and listened to the judge sentence him to 20 years in jail. It was devastating. I asked my wife, do you want to stay here in this city? Do you want to go someplace? Oh, we've got to go someplace else. So we headed east and came to a church where the assistant pastor had spent a week in our home, eating at our table, enjoying our fellowship. We were hungry for someone to care. Someone just to put their arm around. Someone that my wife could cry on their shoulder. That Sabbath was the loneliest Sabbath of our lives. One person in this church of about 500 spoke to us and said, "Happy Sabbath." One person. We were hungry for food, and no one invited us to share their simple meal. I have a friend who tells the story of being invited home, but you'll never guess what. Grilled cheese sandwiches and tomato soup. Anybody here can't make grilled cheese sandwiches? No. Anybody here can open a can of tomato soup and serve it? Yes. You see, well, I have to tell you another little story. My wife makes super good mashed potatoes. And in the years past, there have been occasions when she's tried to cheat a little bit and bought some boxed mashed potatoes. No, it doesn't hold a candle. And I've let her know that's a no-no. But Thursday, when she finished her fast, we stopped at the store and I went and I bought some instant mashed potatoes and I came home and I fixed them for her and they tasted good. You see, when people are hungry, hungry for God's word, hungry for love, hungry for food, those are just things that we can solve. That doesn't have to be pineapple upside down cake. Hey, I'm glad somebody else likes that. You see, that's what my wife makes me when she wants to let me know that she's thinking good thoughts. And I love the way she makes it. But you see, Isaiah was talking to the people of Israel and said, your selfishness is keeping you from keeping the Sabbath. Your selfishness in not looking out for your neighbor, your friends, your own relatives are keeping you from having an enjoyable Sabbath. Because as you read this now, if you turn back your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your own business, and there is that number one again, on my holy day and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable. If you honor it by not going your own ways or seeking your own business or talking idly. Now, there are other translations that I like even better when it talks about talking idly. It says, don't spread vicious rumors. Others say, don't gossip. Now, I think that's probably closer to home, and it hurts when we think about it, but Sabbath is a day to enjoy. I'm glad that at least one person here said amen and another shook their head. Thank you. But how do we enjoy Sabbath? I'm going to be honest with you. I enjoy a little nap. But I know somebody here who doesn't want a nap. In fact, I see four or five of them. And don't you even try to get them to take a nap. Because their nerves and the whole body is just tingling with activity and needs to go and do. And how did God tell us to keep the Sabbath? What was that? To do good. Okay. To do good. You see, when I read here that I'm not supposed to do my own business, that tells me something. I'm to be doing his business. Turn it around. Does that mean that it's not to be enjoyable? Have you ever fed someone who was hungry? Have you ever fed someone who was really hungry? How do you feel? My wife loves to cook. She loves to see people eat. It brings her great joy. I think of one day, and this is long, long ago, I picked up a hitchhiker. And as we talked along the way, he mentioned that he hadn't had anything to eat for several days. I knew that there was some leftover vegetarian stew in the refrigerator. So I said, well, how would you like? Oh, sounds good to me. Well, that was back in the days when Worthington Foods made a beef imitation in little squares with some gravy, and we'd put that in the stew. I warmed it up for him and set it down. He wolfed that right down. He says, that's the best beef I've ever had. It was such a joy to watch him eat. This gives me a little idea of how it can be so happy and joyful in doing God's business. And so, my friends, this text no longer is a mystery to me. It fits with what I know of God, that he wants us to enjoy his Sabbaths, doing his business, not my business. Now, I have to share with you a little thing. I have a feeling that most of you use Amazon at times. Yeah? Yeah? Well, I've gotten to the place where I don't want to place an order on Friday afternoon. You see, I'll place it on Sunday because I want to keep the Sabbath doing his business, not thinking about what I've ordered and anxious for it to arrive. I want to do his business, and so I put it off until Sunday or even Monday. I love Sabbath. Thank you. And I love the way the Jewish people talk about Sabbath, and the way they've numbered the week. You know, it's 6 days till Sabbath. It's 5 days to Sabbath. Oh, it's the preparation day. I love Sabbath. I love doing his business on the Sabbath. And that's part of the joy as a pastor, to share his word on the Sabbath. May God bless you as you enjoy his Sabbath.
Sing them over again to me, wonder.
Loving Father, thank you, thank you, thank you for the Sabbath. Thank you for the joy of fellowship and friendship with you and with each other. And bless us as we do your business on your holy day.